morning. It's a wonderful day, a beautiful day, as we come together to worship our God. And our theme this morning is going to be on independence and our freedom. And so I trust that you've had a good celebration already with the 4th of July. We want to continue that on as we think of this Independence Weekend. Just to let you know a little bit who is here today preaching. My name is Irwin Van Leeuwen, and I'm very familiar with, of course, the church. As I began my ministry in North Dakota, and come down to South Dakota for our classes meetings, and was in the church here a couple different times for classes meetings. I started out in ministry in North Dakota, as I said, and then I moved to Montevideo, Minnesota, and then I spent the last 20 years in ministry at Worthington Church, American Reformed Church in Worthington, Minnesota. I retired 5 years ago today. July 5th was my going away party at the church, but I haven't really quit ministry. I continued to do some preaching, pulpit supplies, and then I went to Arizona, and when I'm in Arizona, they have me preaching up there also, so I still love to share the Word of God, and it's a joy for me to preach the Word. I live in Sioux Falls right now with my wife. We have three children. They all live in Sioux Falls, so that means all nine grandchildren are living in Sioux Falls. We have three step-grandchildren. Two of them live in Sioux Falls. And believe it or not, I'm old enough to have three step-great-grandchildren. So I'm older than what you think. But joy for us to be together in the house of God together. We come in some different times with all this COVID stuff and all that's going on, but it's still, to me, what I really miss the most. You can watch it online, and I'm grateful for people that are watching online, but I miss the church. I miss the fellowship. And it was just a couple weeks ago that we started worshiping in Sioux Falls again. So I'm just glad you're here and we can have together and worship our God. Our call to worship that I selected is from Psalm 95. We read, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." Let us sing together, stand if we're able to, and let's sing together, America the Beautiful.
Thank you.
he will bear much fruit.
Call on the grace team of this time to share us and sing.
What a greeting. Let's give God's greeting to each other. We really don't shake hands with each other, but I kind of like to prefer, let's just turn around and give a holy nod. Okay?
Thank you.
share this morning a service of preparation for the celebration of the Lord's Supper. As has been announced to you in the bulletin, that next Sunday you will be celebrating together at the Lord's table. We would like to just share this service of preparation. It's a time of inward looking. I would encourage us to be thinking of that this morning. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, it is known to you that next Sunday we propose to celebrate together with the gracious help of God the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. That we may celebrate this sacrament to our comfort, it is necessary and rightly to examine ourselves. Let everyone therefore first consider their sins, asking ourselves whether we believe in this faithful promise of God, that all of our sins are forgiven of him only for the sake of the passion and death of Jesus Christ, that the perfect righteousness of Christ is freely given to him as his own, even as perfectly as if he had fulfilled all righteousness. Let everyone ask himself whether he proposes henceforth to show true thankfulness to God for his whole life, to walk uprightly before him, to live in love and peace with our neighbor. All those who are of this mind, God will certainly receive mercy and count them worthy partakers of the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the contrary, according to the command of Christ and the Apostle Paul, we admonish all those who are continuing in unrepentant sin to keep themselves from the Lord's table. This admonition is not intended, dearly beloved, to distress the contrite hearts of his people, as if none might come to the table but those who are without sin. For we do not come to the supper to testify that we are righteous in ourselves, but rather that we are conscious of our sinfulness and trust in Jesus Christ alone for our salvation. Therefore, notwithstanding that we feel that we have not perfect faith and that we do not serve God with such zeal as we ought, we have daily to strive with the weakness of our faith and the evil lusts of our flesh. Yet since we are, by the grace of the Holy Spirit, sorry for these weaknesses and earnestly desirous to fight against our unbelief, and we do live according to the commandments of God, therefore, we rest assured that no sin or infirmity which still remains against our will in us can hinder us from being received of God, from being received in mercy, and from being made worthy partakers of this heavenly food. Let us take a time this morning and examine ourselves as we confess before God our sin. Let's pray. Almighty God, we come before you this morning as we draw near to you to worship, celebrate your presence. We look forward to the time in which we can open your word and study together. But Lord, we also come this morning to prepare our hearts for our communion service next week. It is our prayer, Heavenly Father, that you may open our hearts, that you may reveal within us those things that we have done that are not worthy of each of us. Times where we have done things that are wrong, we have thought things that are not becoming of us as Christians. So Lord, we would confess them before you this morning, asking us that you help us remember our sin and that we would know that we have to confess those sins before you. That as we confess those sins before you, that we know that you are a loving God and a forgiving God, that you do forgive us of our sin as we confess them. So Lord, the quietness of this hour, let's just spend a few moments as we confess our sin to you. Lord God, we would ask that you would hear each of us as we have confessed our sin to you. Thank you for your gracious, forgiving spirit that forgives each of us of all of our sin. Thank you for the love that you have for us. Thank you in your name. Amen. This time let us sing together, He Giveth More Grace. Thank you. Let us come together for our time of prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we come before you this morning, thankful for the opportunity that we have, for the independence that we share, and coming together in this place of worship to lift up your name, to honor you. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the blessings that we experience each and every day. The blessings of life, the blessings of the breath of life, that as you give to us that breath of life, we continue to live, continue to share as a witness of your bounty, of all that you have given to us. Thank you for the love that you have shared with us. Thank you for loving each and every one of us. Lord, we just pray that you will continue to bless us each and every day as we seek to follow you. And lift up, Heavenly Father, the needs of the church as we think of this church extending a call to Scott Nichols. We just pray, Lord, that you will continue to lead him and direct him as to whether he should come here or not. Lord, we would just pray that you would lead him here. We just pray in your will that you would guide and direct. So, Lord, we just leave it up to you. We put it in your hands. We pray that you will continue to surround him with your presence as he makes decisions. Just thank you, Lord, for these churches that have come together and worked together in ministry. Lord, we just pray that you will just continue to bless them in their endeavors as we continue to proclaim the word here in Corsica. For those who listen by means of the electronic times of on YouTube or wherever it may be, we're just grateful, Lord, that we can all be united together through the presence of your Holy Spirit. Your Spirit touches each of us wherever we are, whether we are here physically in this place today or whether we are watching online. Lord, we just are so grateful for the means in which we can get the gospel out and share the word of God with many people. Just pray, Heavenly Father, for those who are in need of your special care. Just pray for Chad or Marla. Just pray that you will watch over them and the needs that they have as they healing care for shut-ins, that your presence would be with them as this is a very lonely time. Just pray, Lord, for this whole pandemic situation that we are part of, this COVID time. Just pray, Lord, that you would soon be able to help the scientists find a vaccine that will stop this virus from spreading and doing so much damage. Lord, we just pray that you will just continue to watch over us and those needs that we have during this time. Lord, we also just want to pray for our freedoms, for the independence that we celebrate this weekend. Just thank you for the men and women of the armed forces that some of them are in harm's way this very hour. Pray that you will protect them and watch over them. We just thank you for what our forefathers have done and people before us. Some of them are relatives who gave up their lives so that we may be free. Heavenly Father, just to have an understanding of that today as we study together from your word. Help us just to take a look at this important word and see what it means in each of our hearts. Lord, we just pray that you will guide and protect us now and bless us as we lift up all of our concerns, our petitions, our joys, and our thanksgivings before you. May you hear each and every person. We thank you, Lord, for the answers that we receive and the prayers that we ask of you. Hear us as we pray. We ask this your name, according to your will. Amen. Let's sing together, I Know Who Holds Tomorrow. Let's stand if we're able to stand, and let's sing together, I Know Who Holds Tomorrow.
Thank you.
we get into the message this morning, I want you to keep thinking of that song. Is that song something you really hold dear to your heart? We don't always know what's all going on tomorrow, but we do know who holds our hand. Kind of another way of saying, are you afraid of anything today? Well, we're going to check that out as we take a look at what freedom means to each one of us. I want to share from you from the Old Testament, from Jeremiah chapter 52. I'll be reading verses 31 through 34. And then one verse from Galatians chapter 5, the first verse. Before we read the Word of God, let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you for the opportunity we have this morning of hearing your Word, reading your Word, and studying your Word. Pray, Lord, that you will just open our hearts, be receptive to your teaching. May your Holy Spirit speak to each one of us this morning. Let me just do a little inward thinking about this word we call freedom. May you bless the words that I will speak. May they be filled with your truth. Guide us, we pray. Amen. Let's read from Jeremiah chapter 52, verse 31. 37th year of the exile of Jehoiachin, king of Judah, and the year of evil Merodach, the king of Babylon. He released Jehoiachin, king of Judah, and freed him from prison on the 25th day of the 12th month. He spoke kindly to him and gave him a great seat of honor, higher than those of the other kings who were with him in Babylon. So Jehoiachin put aside his prison clothes, and the rest of his life ate regularly at the king's table. Day by day, the king of Babylon gave Jehoiachin a regular allowance as long as he lived, till the day of his death. Then from Galatians, the fifth chapter, verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, do not let yourself become burdened again by the yoke of slavery. May God add his richest blessings to these his most holy words as we read them together this morning. I just want to begin this morning by asking each of you a couple questions. What does freedom mean to you? If we had a talk back question and answer session this morning, I would love to hear from you, what does it mean to be free? What does freedom mean to you? But since we're not accustomed to that giving feedback back and forth, I'm just going to kind of ask you to think about it. What would be some words that you would use to describe your freedom? Then the second question I want us to think about is, would your definition of freedom or your expectations of freedom, would it change if you lost your freedom? What would you think about if you lost your freedom? Have you ever thought about that? We are a free nation. We live in freedom. What would it be like if we lose that? So that's where we want to kind of go today. One of the things I have to tell you this morning is that I have a really soft heart, a really tender heart, when it comes to watching people coming back from serving our country in war-torn areas, and they come back home. Doesn't that just thrill your hearts? To me, I have a hard time not getting moisty-eyed. Is there such a word as moisty-eyed? Moisture in my eyes as I watch that happen. I can vividly remember back in 1973, just to let you know how good my memory is. 1973, when the prisoners of the Vietnam War were released, I was into kind of that Vietnam War era because I was in college at that time. We were going through the lottery system, and I just about had my number called up that would be called to service. Some of my friends, some of my churchmates in my Sunday school class gave their life up in Vietnam. And so that war is very close to me. But I was touched and moved beyond control when I watched those prisoners come off that airplane. Some of you may remember, some of you younger children are saying, that's Vietnam War. That's something that we learned in history. But I can see these people, some of them being carried on cots, and they were not able to walk. Others were wheeled in wheelchairs because they were too weak to stand. And still others who would come off that airplane on their own will, and they were so skinny. They were so deprived of food, but they were so happy to be back in America. I remember this one. A gal, they had this area partitioned off where this gal, it's just like I could see it yesterday. They had it partitioned off, and you're not supposed to go on the tarmac. That's where the airplane was, and don't get out there. But her husband came down the steps. She beelined right through that line of defense, and she ran onto that tarmac to hug her husband. Oh, she was so moved. To hear some of the stories that they went through as prisoners of war, how they would know that there were other people in the room, but they could never see each other. And some of them were held in bamboo cages that were so small that you could not even sit up straight. They were not long enough that you could lay down and stretch yourself out. That's where some of them spent 7 and 8 years in captivity. Could you do that? So sure I would make it. I would hope I could, but that would really be pressing me, I would think. But they would talk about how they would have to figure out a system, how they could communicate to each other. So they did it by tapping on the ground. And it was almost kind of like a Morse code they would develop. They couldn't talk to each other, but with continuous tapping and all that kind of stuff, they were able to read each other and communicate, never knowing who their names were. Never saw each other until they were released. Others who would say that they would spend time banging their heads against the cages, on the walls, on the floors, so that their face would have bruises, so that the enemy could not show them off what kind of great care they were given to these people. Being a prisoner, I wonder what they think about freedom. And I wonder what it's like for them as they came off that plane and as they tasted that freedom again and they were free. Amazing. This is last week, I think it was Tuesday or Wednesday, I was watching the news and sure enough, here comes this young man to his home to see his family for the first time after being 10 months deployed. In Afghanistan, came home to hold his son that he'd never seen before, that was born a couple months before he got home. He was able to hold his son for the first time. As other children were just so excited, I tell you, I almost have to turn it up because that just kind of makes me blubber. And that's a good emotion. But how we celebrate that kind of freedom that they have, and they can enjoy that freedom. But what are they thinking about when they're held captive? What's freedom like for them then? I want to tell you about this story in Jeremiah. I am sure that, I'm pretty safe in saying this, that most of you did not even know that was in the Bible. Is that true? I was not aware. Jehoiachin, some of you who have studied all the kings and so on, you probably remember all the different kings, the good kings and the bad kings, but let me just kind of briefly set up the story, because it's a fascinating story. We don't know a whole lot about Jehoiachin, But Jehoiachin is the son of Jehoiakim. That was his dad. And his dad was the king in Judah during the time that Nebuchadnezzar was the king in Babylon. And his dad, Jehoiakim, reigned for about 11 years. We read back in 2 Kings how he was a bad king. He did not fear God. But he was a king nonetheless. After he passes, they give the crown to his son, Jehoiachin. Jehoiachin had a desire of bringing hope to the people. His reign lasted 3 months. 3 months he was king, and then King Nebuchadnezzar took him over and placed him in exile, which is a fancy word of saying put him in jail. He was in jail for 37 years. Now think of that, 37 years. I retired 5 years ago after spending 39 years in ministry. And I'm thinking, he spent all of his time that I was in a minister, spent all that time in prison. And I'm sure that many people kind of forgot about him, and nobody's paying attention to him. Well, then Nebuchadnezzar is no longer on the scene. The next king is Evil the Doradok. That sounds like an encouraging name, doesn't it? Evil the Doradok. And he is now the king of Babylon. And one of the first things that he does, I don't understand why, one of the first things that he does is he releases Jehoiachin from prison after being in prison for 37 years. I wonder what's going through his mind sitting there for 37 years wondering if he would ever see the light of day again outside his cell. But now he is given his freedom. He is set free. What we read in the scriptures as he put off his prison clothes and put on some good clothes, and he dined with the king. We read he was an evil king. He still did not fear the Lord. But he was not a God-fearing person, but he is free now from the confinement of prison. And the king of Babylon now gives him a place of honor, and he is able to sit in the palace and dine with the king. It says in the scriptures that he even had more rank or more prestige than some of the other kings in Babylon. Every day, this evil Doradok, would give him a stipend, give him something to live on. And every day, he would celebrate the presence of the king. Freedom. What does it mean to him when he lost his freedom and then has it back? What goes through the minds of a person in war when they're no longer free, they're held under the enemy's capture, and then are set free? It's an amazing thing to think about, at least for me. What about you? What does freedom mean to you? Has the last few weeks past month shaking you a little bit inside? I have to be honest with you, and I have to be careful on how I say it, but I have to say to you that I feel sometimes we have lost some of our freedom in our country. We are not as free as what we once thought we were. From some of the experiences that we have gone through the last few weeks, my freedom seems to be taken away. I don't like it. I don't like what I see. I don't like what happens to people that just kind of run rampant around and they can destroy anything in this country they want to destroy. Some of them destroying monuments that they don't even know what they stand for.
It's not good. It's not a good part of our history, so let's get rid of it. Let's tear it apart. Let's destroy it. Because we say we have that right. We have that right to just do what we want to do. And those of you who really feel that you are free, you can just watch. Should we just watch? What is our response when people challenge our freedoms? What is our response when people do things that we don't want, we don't like to be done? I have to say, in sadness, we don't do much. Have you heard the last few weeks? Very many people speak up about what's happening in our country. Nobody cares. If you would dare say something, they might burn your house down, burn your business down, shoot you. Horrific shootings again this weekend in Chicago. Children being shot. They're dead. And nobody dares to really stand up to that. Now, I was thinking this week as I was thinking of this message, you know, there's a lot of things going on in the Old Testament. The Israelites, were they always such good people? Did they ever dishonor God? They most certainly did. In fact, there were times that they even worshiped golden calves. But does that mean now as a Christian that I've got to take and rip out all those pages in the Old Testament making reference to that? Because that's a bad part of our history. No, we don't do that. We learn from our history. We learn from the good and from the bad. That's part of our history that helps shape us to who we are today. That's why it saddens me in our country that nobody is speaking up and saying, hey, wait a minute. You can't destroy our history. You can't rewrite our history. Let's learn from history because I'm a free person. Paul says in Galatians that he has set me free. Jesus Christ has set me free. Our freedom is in Christ who has set us free. Don't go back and be enslaved again. Don't be in bondage of those sinful things of our past, what we have had as a part of our life, but now are lifted from us because Christ has made us free. Why wouldn't we live as people who are free? That's why I said to you at the beginning of the message, what does freedom mean to you? It should not mean that we're silent. It should mean that we are willing to speak up for the truth of God's word. And that we would continue to be living witnesses of the freedom we have in Christ. A couple things I want to challenge you to do this week. And I know many of you have done it already. But let me just challenge you again. That first of all, I believe as Christians, we need to honor those who have given our freedom. Who have made us free. We need to honor and give honor and respect to our Lord Jesus Christ, who has truly set us free. We need to honor men and women who are willing and brave enough to fight for our freedom. Some of them giving their lives so we may be free. And we need to honor people who are protecting our freedoms. So the first thing we need to do on Independence Weekend, not just on this weekend, but every day, is honor those who have given us freedom. Secondly, I believe we need to pray for those who lead us. I believe it is so important for us to pray for our leaders. I don't always agree with all the things that are going on in the Democrat and Republican parties, but I have to pray for our leaders. We need to pray for one another. We need to seek in prayer those who are leading us, that God's Spirit would be upon them, not to destroy and be so destructive through the words that we say, the things that we do, that we may pray peace, the peace of God to be upon them. For Christ has set us free. And then thirdly, I think the third thing we do need to do is not be silent. We need to be willing to speak up to those who are destroying our freedom. I remember a couple years ago, there was a company, a very big company, who felt that it was just immoral for them to have to offer abortion rights, insurances to their employees. They didn't like it, it was against their Christian principles. They're going to fight it. They fought it all the way to the Supreme Court. And we celebrated the victory. But the Supreme Court said, no, you do not have to offer that. You do not have to offer those abortion rights to people that are working for you. We celebrated that victory. But do you know that it was a 5-4 decision? One vote the other way, we would have lost that freedom. My opinion should have been a 9-0 vote, but it wasn't. Not everybody sees freedom the way I see it, the way you see it. But when we are free through the blood of Jesus Christ, we need to be willing to speak up. Say, we are free people in Christ. And what is going on is not right. And we do it in love. We do it in respect. We do it in peace. Let us not be silent. One of those people that were held in captivity in Vietnam said this: they can take everything away from us, but they could not take prayer. They could not take my prayer away. That's what we have also. Let us be prayer warriors for the kingdom of God. Let us be prayer warriors for our own nation. But friends, I do believe our freedoms are challenged. And I want to stay free. I thank God for the freedom I have in Christ. Father, you have given us a lot to think about as you've guided us by your word. Thank you, Lord, for the freedom that we have in you. And I just pray, Lord Jesus, that you will guide each and every one of us as we think about freedom, what it means to be free. May we speak up for our freedoms and be willing to tell people that we will not think it's right. Destroy our history and show disrespect to those who have fought for our freedoms. Bless and keep each one of us, Heavenly Father. May we understand that we are free indeed through the blood of Jesus Christ. And we celebrate that next week through communion. Bless us, we pray. Amen. Let's stand if we're able and let's sing together our country of his city. Thank you.
I deposit that after the service in the back. Let's pray for God's blessing. Father in heaven, we do pray and give thanks to you for the gifts that we're able to give to your service. Thank you so much for the dedication of your people, as it is our desire to seek to praise you and to honor you. So Lord, we pray that you'll bless each giver, bless each gift that is given, that your word may be made known. Children, free by the blood of Jesus Christ. Go in his peace.